This is Kevin Gianni from the Renegade Health Show, and today is Monday, and today we're going to answer some of your questions. But first, I want to tell you that the 30-day transformation challenge, the applications, the last day we're going to take those are this Sunday coming up. So that's the last day. So to recap what the 30-day challenge is we come to you. It can either be you, your family, or a group of your friends. And what we do is we come to your place for 30 days. We're not going to stay there for 30 days or anything. We're going to be in the RV. But what we're going to do is we're going to put you on a plan, and we're going to help you get the weight loss results that you want. So, you have to be willing to do it. You have to be willing to be filmed. You have to really be ready for a change. And if you are that person, we're going to pick a few of them this year, and we're going to come to your house, and we're going to show you all the things that need to be done. We're going to just take you through the whole thing, exercise and health. We're going to put you on a little detox plan. Hopefully, we'll be able to work with some of your local practitioners as well to help you guys out, and to form a relationship with them. So that's the plan. So the first round of applications, they are due, this is your homework, they are due on this Sunday coming up. So this is the Sunday was 14th, so the 21st, February 21st, is going to be the last day we'll accept these applications. After that, what we're going to be doing is we're going to be reviewing the applications and then deciding, picking out the ones that kind of fit the criteria that we're looking for, and then we're going to send an additional round of application from there. So let's get into the questions. Here we go. I'm going to get some YouTube questions going here because I know you guys on YouTube asked some questions. So I scanned some of the last posts and we're going to answer some of your questions today. So here we go. K-C-I-G Mon, maybe that's how you pronounce that, I don't know, says, I want to start juicing, but I just can't afford a quality juicer and do not want to purchase a cheap one, only to waste more product. And I know you have covered green powders before. I just want to know if I can use a green powder in the place of juicing for the time being. Is it worth it nutritionally speaking? I have a blender that I'm going to use that, but I would like just your opinion. Okay, this is kind of a little convoluted question, so there's a couple things here. Juicing is going to be better than a green powder because you actually retain the liquid that comes from the vegetable. So you're going to be able to absorb the nutrients in that liquid that it comes with, and you're going to have more nutritional vibrancy from a live juice than you would from a green powder. So for the time being, I mean, I would get a Jack O'Lane juicer. It's $99. You can throw stuff in there. It's real easy to use. It's not that easy to clean, but if you're not juicing, two, three times a day, it'll last you for a little bit, and that might be the best way to go before you can, save up for a Green Star, which we think is, really the pinnacle of juicers in terms of affordability and usability. So, the Norwalk juicer is great, but it's $2,000, so not a lot of us have $2,000 to throw to a juicer. The Green Star at $500, $600 can really get you in there and be a really good machine that'll last you a really long time. The other question here is, in terms of nutritionally speaking, green powder might have, more variety of different foods than you're juicing. But again, that living element of juices, it's so important. Last, I have a blender. Use the blender for juicing. Get, blend up the, if you have a Vitamix, blend up, your juice material. So, lettuce or, kale or lemon or whatever else you want to do. Blend it up, put some water in there, and then strain it through a nut milk bag. And you'll actually be able to get a lot of benefits of great juice. That's how we juice right now, because it's a pain to take out the big old Green Star and then put it away and all that sort of stuff because we just don't have enough room on the counter. So those are some of my opinions. There, some people might say that a green powder is better because there's more nutrients in it. We can give or take, but the live aspect of food is just so important. We can't overlook that. Starflower asks, how to overcome mineral deficiencies quickly once you know that you're low. This is a good question. So what you're going to do is this. First off, you want to make sure that your D levels are sufficient. So you want to get a vitamin D test and see if your levels of D are sufficient, because D will help you absorb particularly calcium and other minerals. So get everything moving effectively. The second thing that I would do is there's like a trilogy or even more things that you can do to help get your minerals up. And this is one, get a trace mineral supplement. Two, not in any order, sorry. One trace mineral supplement that's low in sodium. 2, you can use seaweeds. 3, you can use marine phytoplankton. 4, you can use green juices. And those are some of the things that I've used to help rebuild my minerals after my mineral deficiencies. So those are the 4 things that I would absolutely, you know, look into, and know that if you're kind of embarking on this, to go back and test again to make sure it's working, because if it's not working, you might need to go out and get something a little more stronger or a little more therapeutic than some of those substances. So you want to monitor it, because you can take those things, and then, you know, if it doesn't happen to work for you, maybe your digestion is poor, your absorption is really poor, then, you know, you're going to be wasting your money. You're better off finding something that's therapeutic, working with a practitioner, and making sure that you do raise your mineral levels, because low mineral deficiencies over a long period of time turn into disease. Let's see, M. Rizma says, I live in Hawaii. How do you open raw macadamia nuts? Awesome. So there is a video that we did at Glen Ivy Farm in Corona, California. So if you type Glen Ivy Farm, Glen Ivy Renegade Health in Google, you'll find that video. And it shows us actually cracking them on the pavement. We put a rock down, and then we put the nut down, and then hit another rock on top of it. So you can crack it that way, or you can get a Mac nut crusher, which is a machine that you crank, and it puts pressure up against the nut, and then it cracks the shell, and then it opens up, and then you pop it open, and then you eat it. Those are the 2 ways to open up a macadamia nut. One is easier, for people who, don't want to sit outside and, smash rocks, together and all that sort of stuff. The Mac nut crusher is easier, but it's going to be more expensive, so it's entirely up to you. Let's see, Zoe Bella asks, do you think an electric knife could cut through a coconut? It could definitely cut through one of the young coconuts. It's just a matter of how you want to open it up. There's a lot of ways to do it. A lot of people posted a lot of different ways. So yeah, you could try an electrical knife, see what happens. Make sure you keep it away from your hands. That's the only advice that I have. ULance29 says, can you show us how to properly slice open a chicken? No. let's see. Someone said, I didn't get who asked this question, but can you tell us the health benefits of the young coconut jelly? They're a good source of medium chain fatty acids are easily turned into energy in your body, so they don't have a really long transfer process in the system, so you can turn those into energy fairly effectively. It's also a great source of caprylic acid, which is a fatty acid, and caprylic acid is great antifungal type properties, so antifungal properties are really important to wash through our system time and time again to make sure that everything is kosher in your digestive tract. And let's see, last question is, if you're in an area like you were and could get abundance of coconuts or find somewhere to buy them in bulk, what's their shelf life after being harvested? I found some the other day and picked one up. It was fairly large, had a lot of water in it, but it was nearly no meat, so maybe a tablespoon. So only a little bit of meat, which is okay. That means it's, it's just younger coconut. And if you find them in bulk, the shelf life is generally about a month. You want to kind of keep them in the shade. Generally about a month, they'll be all right. And you can, obviously check them out. You open them up, crack them open. If they start to get brown, gray, the water starts to get gray. It starts to taste a little bitter, funky. That's when it's done. Sometimes if it turns pink, like the young Thai coconut, some of them will turn like really pink. It's not going to be good. You want to make sure that you just stop using the ones that you have if they're that color, and then harvest again. All right, your question of the day is this. Since we talked about juicing in the beginning of this episode, what I want to know is, what do you juice with? Go ahead and post that down below. Do you even use a juicer? Why or why not? This is Kevin Gianni. Pass this show along, just like all the other ones. Together we can change the health of the world, one show at a time.